Now this morning we're going to continue looking at some examples on how when we stay long enough in the presence of God, God speaks to us, and in speaking to us, we begin to listen to His word. It's so important that we listen to the voice of God. We listen to the voice of God because the voice of God gives direction to our lives. The voice of God shows us what is to come. And like I told you earlier, the voice of God is not primarily visions and dreams. It is God speaking to your heart. And when He speaks to your heart, you will hear Him. People call it by different names, but if you learn to listen long enough to that inner voice, it becomes clearer and clearer and clearer by the day. Incidentally, there are times when that's exactly the way that the word of knowledge or the word of wisdom operates in meetings. Of course, there are times when God shows a minister of the gospel, be it a man or a woman, something supernaturally in the spirit realm. And they begin to see things in the spirit realm. But primarily, when a man or a woman of God is ministering, the inner voice of the Spirit of God is so loud. It is as though God is telling you something. And it is in those times when men of God or women of God yield to the Spirit of God and speak forth what is shown. The gifts of the Spirit operate. Either it is a word of wisdom or a word of knowledge, or the simple gift of prophecy in operation, which edifies the church, comforts the church, and which is actually inspired speaking forth of God's word. So the gifts of the Spirit begin to operate. Now last week we looked at an amazing portion of scripture from Luke's Gospel chapter 1. And we were seeing how Zechariah was struck dumb, and the string of his tongue was not loosed till he agreed with what God had spoken to him about in private. Remember, when he was ministering to God, while he was in the temple, in verse 22, and you will see a little earlier also, in verse 10 and 11 of verse at Luke's Gospel chapter 1, how he was inside and he was required to burn incense. The burning of incense signified the offering of praise and worship, as well as prayer. So this man was doing it when he saw somebody who spoke to him. Look at verse 11 says, and there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord. So what he received in the Cether of God was a revelation of the child which was to come. Now having said that, I told you how Elizabeth went into her Cether as well. For 6 months, she hid her pregnancy. And there are times we need to understand that when God speaks to us about something, it's not immediately you go and declare what He said to everybody. Often people learn the hard way when they do what Joseph did in the book of Genesis. They share what they have with the wrong person. The wrong person doesn't appreciate you hearing from God. The wrong person doesn't appreciate the fact that God spoke to you. The wrong person mocks what you have done and what you have heard and what the Lord will do. And sooner or later you find that what you heard is now under question. You begin to question what you heard. Now Elizabeth was old and stricken in years like her husband was. She didn't want anyone messing up with what had happened to her. For 6 months she hid her pregnancy even from her relatives. And that's what I showed you last week. The person who told Mary, her cousin, about her pregnancy was God himself through the angel. Mary didn't know Elizabeth was pregnant. And it's good for us to understand what the Cether means. The Cether means it's a place of covering, protection, a place where you are hid till God reveals his plan and purpose through your life. When people don't understand the Cether, they become frustrated. They think God's forgotten me. God's not forgotten anybody. And that's why God's bringing our focus back to the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd never forgets his sheep. Remember, he's ready to leave 99 healthy, well-fed, protected sheep and go after that one lost sheep. So we're talking about a shepherd who sees not just the majority, but he also sees the minority. Can I have an amen from this church, please? And he knows everybody by name. And it's good for us to understand that when Zechariah declared with his lips, the name of this child will be John. First in writing, and then later when he began to see, his mouth opened. The name didn't change. The name continued to be John. Only now Zechariah was prophesying what John would do. Look at verse 75-76. We read these words last week. In holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. We want to serve the Lord. We want to minister to the Lord. Luke 1:75-76. And thou child, he's referring to John, shall be called the prophet of the highest. I want you to mark that down. A priest was declaring a prophetic ministry on his son, which was not the norm. It was not normal for this kind of a situation to happen, because priests' sons became priests. They would prophesy when the ephod was on them, but otherwise they remained as priests. But look at this verse, please. And thou child shall be called the prophet of the highest. I wanted to circle the word prophet of the highest. For thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge and salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender blood mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us. Now the day spring from on high, it's a beautiful name for God. It reveals to us how God is. Giver of life. Producer of everything good. Most importantly, the day spring, the source of every good blessing. Now, having said that, you and I are tempted to think immediately Must have been easy. The call was there. Once the call is there, immediately, doesn't God take and use a man? After all, he's a called vessel. And I wanted to see something about the Cether there. To give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace, into the way of shalom. So this prophet of the highest would do something. He would go before the face of the Lord, and the Lord would give light to them that sit in darkness, and the Lord would give light to them in the shadow of death, and the Lord would guide the feet of his people in the way of peace. Jehovah Rohi. Jehovah Rohi. Now, having made the beautiful prophetic word on the little child John at his birth, what was the way in which this child would grow up? Would he somehow bypass the Cether of God? After all, such a prophetic word, such a fantastic background, coming from a priestly house, coming from a background of people serving the Lord, not just in an ordinary measure, but in the very presence of God, standing and offering incense before God. Look at verse 80. Now this is talking about the one whom Jesus himself acknowledged as the greatest who were born among men in the Old Testament. And the child grew and waxed strong in the spirit, and was in the desert till the day of his showing unto Israel. The Cether was the deserts, dry places, wilderness-like situation. Do I hear an amen from this church? You don't like it? You'll have to accept it. You can't bypass the Cether of God. God wants to use you in some way. Then he will take you into a place that is much like a desert. You will not be seen by the common man. You will not be seen by anybody but by God. Till he shows you to who? His covenant people, Israel. Till then, you will not be seen. Till then you will not be seen. Till then you will not be noticed. So till that time, you must stay put in the desert. You shouldn't say, I have a prophetic ministry. All that I need to do is just go and say something to somebody. You'll blow it. You got to wait. Wait till God leads you out of the desert and into the public domain. And this happens for anybody who wants to be used of God. There will be this kind of a Cether period. That's what you will find that most preachers will refer to as silent years. Wilderness-like situations. God doesn't want you there. He wants you before the people. He wants you ministering. But prior to ministering, you should have spent time in his presence. Because I want you to see this. Till the day of his showing unto Israel, he was where? In the desert. Waxing strong in the spirit. Can I have an amen? Waxing strong in the spirit. Not weak in the spirit. So, if you're going to conclude what we have read from Luke's Gospel chapter 1, we must arrive at the conclusion that not to spend time in the Cether will make you weak. Do I have an amen, please? If you don't spend time with God, you become a weak individual. Doesn't matter who you are. You will not be strong in the spirit. The first part of the verse, 80, talks about the physical side. He grew. The second part of the verse, which is actually the middle part of the verse, wax strong in spirit. Strong is connected to Cether, living. Do you like this time of intercession and fasting and prayer? Do you enjoy it? When you start enjoying being with God, you're already starting to wax strong in the spirit. Your inner man becomes strong. It's only a matter of time after that before you will be produced before covenant people. Because God now knows, this man has spent time with me and is strong in spirit. This is not just talking about a child growing up before God. No. It is not talking about it. It's talking about a child who grew in the presence of God. And for the most part of his life, and I want you to write it down, please. For the most part of his life, was in the deserts. He was not in the synagogue. He was not in the temple prisons playing with the other priest children. He was not in Jericho, where all the Levites and the priests stayed when their work in the temple was over. The Bible tells us he was in the deserts. And I just want you to write it the way I'm telling it to you. Just write it the way I'm telling it to you. Because when God leads you sometimes away, it's painful. Because you're all alone there. And unless you know that God is with you and God is speaking to you, and he is developing your spirit in the inner man, then somehow you're not going to see the entirety of the purpose of Cether living. Cether living means growing up and waxing strong. Growing up, waxing strong. Now this morning I want to read to you again from the Moffat's translation of Hebrews 4, 12 and 13. Hebrews 4, 12 and 13 from the Moffat's translation. If you have already written it the first time, I read it out to you. But if you have left out in some place, some words, you can make a note of it again. I'm going to read it slowly. For the Logos of God, the Logos of God, L-O-G-O-S, for the Logos of God is a living thing. The Logos of God is a living thing. Active and more cutting. Active and more cutting than any sword with a double edge. Than any sword with a double edge, penetrating to the very division of soul and spirit. Penetrating to the very division of soul and spirit, joints and marrow. And I want to tell you something about this marrow. Remember some years ago when we were ministering to a man who had come down from Sri Lanka, needed a bone marrow transplant done on him. We didn't get to see him first. We got to see his wife first. And we used to stand and minister to her on the corridor. And she would be all tensed because of this bone marrow transplant. Because when the transplant is done, generally, the resistance power of the person who is going through the bone marrow transplant is so low. The blood count is so low that they are so susceptible to any form of infection. That's why they are placed in an isolated wing of the hospital. In fact, if you go to the other parts of the place where they are kept, those places are neat as well. The doctors still feel they need isolation, so they will be in an isolated place. And I remember that the Lord led us to give this word and another word from the book of Proverbs as well. And we heard that sister look at us and say, I never thought about it like that. And she held on to this scripture. She was not from a Pentecostal background. She was from a Roman Catholic background. Her husband was a Buddhist. But then while she was there in hospital and as we kept ministering to her, she accepted the Lord. And the good news is she went back with her husband who was healed. That's the good news. Did we pray for others who died? Yes. Yes. But that doesn't stop us from giving the good news to people. Anyhow, we can't heal anybody. Jesus never asked us to get all caught up with the healing that we stop giving out God's word once we see somebody not healed. It's his wisdom ultimately that must prevail. It's our dependence on him that counts. So we gave her this word. Look at it. It's able to divide spirit from soul, joints and marrow, scrutinizing the very thoughts and conceptions of the heart. Scrutinizing the very thoughts and conceptions of the heart. And no created thing is hidden from him. That's the good news. It didn't say no created thing is hidden from it. Moffat was a very learned man. But he called the logos of God him. Because in the beginning was the logos of God. The word of God. And the Logos was with God. And the Logos was God. Can I have an amen? John 1:1. You read it like how we are seeing Moffat translated it. You will find John's gospel the most exciting gospel. It's not talking about it. It's talking about him. It's talking about him in all his glory. In fact, if you go to a proper Bible college, they will tell you that the Gospel of John is so different from the other three Gospels. The Gospel of John is so different from the other three Gospels. Now, follow please. All things lie open and exposed before the eyes of him. All things lie open and exposed before the eyes of him with whom we have to reckon. You can't hide anything from him because our final reckoning is with him. Remember, he's called the Lord God of recompenses. He said he will recompense. Now, in Psalm 119, we see another reason for staying long enough in the presence of God. We stay long enough to meditate on Him. Stay long enough to meditate on Him. I want you to turn with me, please, in your Bibles to Psalm 119. But before that, I'd like to just give you the verse, chapter and verse for the Lord God of recompenses. Jeremiah chapter 51 and verse 56. Jeremiah 51 and verse 56. Because the spoiler is come upon her, even upon Babylon, and her mighty men are taken, every one of their bows is broken. For the Lord God of recompenses shall surely requite. So He is called the Lord God of recompenses. Now Psalm 119. You can write close to the Lord God of recompenses, Psalm 94, Psalm 94, 1 as well. Now, Psalm 119, look at verse 97. Oh, how love I thy law. It is my meditation all the day. I wanted to see something about what the psalmist said. What was he doing all the day long? Meditating on the law of God. Often people look askance at anyone who says, I was meditating on God's word for quite some time. They think you're doing it because you have time on your hands. They're busy. You have free time on your hands, so then you can think on God and His word. Nothing can be further from the truth than that. Erroneous kind of a mindset. I want to show you this, please. Soon after saying verse 97, the psalmist says, Thou through thy commandments hast made me wiser than my enemies, for they are ever with me. That means he was not just sitting at home meditating God's word. He was in the midst of people plotting and planning his downfall. What kept him ahead of them was God's word. So do we have a choice really about meditating on God's word? No. Because we must know that every day of our lives, there is a constant attack on our lives from different sources. Look at verse 99. I have more understanding than all my teachers. Why? For thy testimonies are my meditation. This man was meditating on blood covenant so much. And everything related to the blood covenant so much. That he had more understanding in his time than all the ones who had taught him. And this is not a denouncing of teachers in the body of Christ. This is not a denial of their ministry, but it shows us that if a man will meditate on the blood covenant long enough, he will have more understanding than the ones who have taught him earlier. And that's the good news. Because in every generation we want God to bless us, God to prosper us, God to keep us, God to see what we are doing. In our lives we want His blessing. So I want you to please write it down. Psalm 119. In verse 99, more understanding than all my teachers, for their testimonies are my meditation. Now, somehow, there is a strong link between understanding and wiser than enemies that is connected to meditation. Verse 98, wiser than your enemy. Jesus taught about being wiser than serpents, harmless like doves. So when we are talking about being wiser than our enemies, we are not discounting the fact that the enemy is wise. But the believer who meditates on God's word is wiser. Wiser. So when they sit and plot and plan against you, and they're sitting and plotting and planning and drawing up plans about your downfall, if you make God's word your meditation all day long, you will be wiser than them. And this is a guarantee. This is a guarantee. Then, more understanding. This is not to look at people who teach and mock them. No. This is talking about an understanding that comes on the basis of meditation. Now, is it meditation like we understand it here in India, where you cut yourself off from people, you just sit and keep repeating just one word over and over again, or focusing on that one word, much like you do in hypnotism, where you focus so strongly on one thing, having emptied your mind of everything else, that sooner or later you find yourself transported into a new realm, where you become open to different forms of supernatural occurrences. Is that what we're talking about? No. Let's look at it the Bible way. The way the book of Psalms starts off with. The blessedness that comes to a man. The empowerment that comes to a man. Psalm 1, please. Psalm 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Empowered for good success is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. That means the ungodly gives you counsel, you execute the counsel. That's walking in the counsel of the ungodly. Should I tithe? Someone who never tithes, who's ungodly. So I want you to understand the word ungodly. Ungodly means God is not on the man's thoughts. The acts of God mean nothing to such a man. The works of God mean nothing to such a man. The presence of God means nothing to such a man. So when you're talking about an ungodly person, it need not necessarily be an unbeliever who is not born again. It can be a man who is born again, but God is not on his thoughts. And I want you to write it, please. Because sometimes we say, well, we don't have any unbelieving friends. But sometimes you have the wrong kind of believing friends. They don't have God on their mind. It's true, they don't have God on their mind. He's the last person they'll call when they're in trouble. Some of them are so arrogant, they'll never want to pray. God is not on their thoughts. Now, if you go to such a man and ask counsel, he is going to give you wrong counsel. And if you walk in his counsel, you will be walking in ungodliness. Do I need to go to church today? You ask the wrong person, he says, no, you don't need to go to church today. See me, I'm not going to church today. Well, what do we do then? Let's go to the shopping mall. Let's go to the mall and sit there. So the ungodly person leads you away from God. Number one, counsel of the ungodly. Number two, now standeth in the way of sinners. A sinner is a man who has not come under the blood of God. He has not been born again. His sins still remain in his life. Most often they are unbelievers. Their sin still remains in them. Standing in the way of sinners. What is the meaning of that? The sinners have a lifestyle that they follow. It's a way of living, they say. They love sin more than righteousness. That is the path they have adopted. Now, if you go and stand in the way of sinners, it's not standing in their way and stopping them and saying, no, turn around, come to righteousness. No, no, no. It's not talking about that. It's saying standing in that way of the lifestyle of sinning. Sooner or later, they will move your mind away from God. That's what I wrote about even in the newsletter. Why did God forbid the Israelites to marry ungodly women? After all, he created man and woman. He did not create them to say, don't go with women. No. He specifically instructed covenant people not to marry non-covenant people. Why? Because he said subtly, very, very slowly but surely, they will turn your heart away from following the living God. Because they have a lifestyle of sinning. Their lifestyle of sinning is connected with the lifestyle of worshipping sin. Because in their heart, sin still remains. And I want you to write this down, because this is one of the most commonest questions people in the church have. Can I just marry an unbeliever? Why do you say don't marry an unbeliever? I'll marry the unbeliever and then get the person to Christ. And sometimes the pressure is so much being put on parents and leaders in the church. And often people stop even coming to church because of that. They think we're too dogmatic about this, getting married to believers. And they'll ask you a question, what if there's no believer in town? Now, it's not for us to give answers to every question that is put to us. One thing we know, God is wise enough to instruct his people in the ways of wisdom. Can I have an amen, please? God is wise enough. God is not foolish. Someone the other day was making mention of wanting to marry a Buddhist. So I was standing and listening to this person. And this person looked at me and said, like we have the Ten Commandments, they have 10 laws as well. I looked at the person, I didn't know what to do. Here's a person who knows the Lord, but who's justifying 10 tenets of belief and equating it to the 10 commandments of God. They have no comparison. Can I have an amen? There's no comparison to the 10 commandments in any religion. The 10 commandments come from a living God. And they're meant to give life, not meant to give death. But the problem is we don't have the capacity to follow them in our own strength. That's where the problem lies. Not in the law of God, in us. That's why we have to be born again. That's why we need to be empowered of God's Spirit. That's why we need the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Now follow. So don't stand in the way of sinners. They will turn your heart away from God. They did the same thing for Solomon also. Solomon was such a wise man. Actually, to tell you the truth, it's little surprising, but God never told Solomon, you made a mistake because of the 700 wives and 300 concubines you had. What made God angry was towards the end of Solomon's days, the wives he had married from other nations, heathen women, sinners, turned the heart of Solomon away in his old age and made him to come and stand before their idol gods while they were offering incense. And God didn't like that. God was the person who had lifted up Solomon. Solomon by himself as a man was useless. He didn't have what it took to become anybody. And I can prove that to you very simply. When his older brother grabbed the throne, Adonijah, Solomon didn't have the guts to go and tell Adonijah, who are you? Yes or no? You don't read about Solomon once going down to battle. You don't read of once Solomon going out to battle. David was a fighting man, not Solomon. Solomon by himself was not that sharp like David was. What made Solomon the king that we all know him to be was God's blessing of wisdom and riches that he had given the boy. And God was very upset. It displeased God that the man he had raised up to be such a powerful influence that everybody all over the world felt in the time of Solomon that it was good to be in Solomon's camp. It was good to come into the presence of the king, because they would see the wisdom of God in manifestation and they would see the splendor of God's kingdom in manifestation. And that's why God raised up an adversary. Yes or no? How many of you know what we're talking is true? Can I have an amen? It was not because of the wives. It was because of the wives who had come into Solomon's life, who had turned his heart away, that made him to sin in his old age. Now follow, please. The third thing, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. There is a bema of the scornful. There is a bema of the blood. The word B-E-M-A, bema, in Hebrew is the word for seat. Literally a cover, a lid. The mercy seat of God promises any man can come to God through the blood and God will accept him. Mercy is immediately expressed to such an individual. But there is another place where people sit. They are the scorners, scornful. That means everything they see is disregarded in their heart. One example we see of this is when Elijah was taken up in that beautiful chariot of fire. Amazing situation. Elisha saw his mentor being caught up in the chariot of fire. And then the mantle fell. And he picks the mantle and rends it in two and then strikes the river Jordan and crosses across the Jordan on dry ground. And then when he enters the city, there's a group of 42 young men. Bible calls them children. Now they mock Elisha. How do they mock him? They use a phrase, "Go up thy bald head." Now they were not just attacking the person of Elisha. And I want you to write this example down. They were not attacking the person of Elisha. They were mocking the way in which God chose to take a man supernaturally since the days of Enoch, where the Bible says Enoch walked with God and God took him. He was not, for God took him. A man was supernaturally taken up to heaven. And it didn't make an impression on those 42 children. I just want you to write it down. It didn't impress them. They were not impressed. Today there are people who are not impressed when a blind man is healed by the healing anointing of God. There are people who are not impressed when the dumb sing, the deaf hear, the lame walk. They are not impressed. Still they will mock the preacher. Still they will scorn the healing anointing. They will attack a man left, right and center. They think they are doing good. They are not doing good. They are actually seated in the seat of the scornful. They are scorning God. They are scorning what he is doing. So what happened to the 42 children? The Bible says Elisha turned and cursed them. And after he had cursed, two she-bears came, tore the 42 children and killed them. You would think it's a very, very harsh judgment which was pronounced on those 42, because we get so caught up with the word children. We say, why on earth can this happen? Didn't God reprimand the prophet? No, he didn't. He confirmed what the prophet said. He confirmed what the prophet said because he still confirms he is not on the side of the scornful. Children must learn to respect God from a young age. Do I hear an amen from this church, please? Children must learn the fear of God from a young age. Adults must know what it is to fear God. Teenagers must know what it is to fear God. Why? Because scornful is not just talking about elderly people. It can be any age group where the spirit of scorning takes preeminence over the fear of God. Having seen the three different groups of people, ungodly, sinners, scornful. I'm again going to repeat. Ungodly, sinners and scornful. What does this man delight in? His delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law doth he meditate day and night. Day and night, what thrills his being is God's word. It is not the way of the ungodly, or the counsel of the ungodly, or the way of sinners, or the seat of the scornful. He's not longing for their company. Some people wait for prayer to get over. Why? Because they want to run and sit with the scornful. They want to go and sit with them and scorn everything that they heard or saw. And it is there in every congregation. It's there in every place all over the world. For them, scorning has become a way of life. Look at the man who's empowered for good success. His delight is in the law of the Lord. And he doesn't just say, I'll set apart one time in the morning and after that, the day is mine. I've already given you your due, Lord. Now don't expect anything from me. No. He meditates on the word day and night. The word meditate in Hebrew is the word mutter. Mutter. To mutter aloud. You can mutter aloud under your breath and still maintain your sanity. Some people think, what will happen if I start speaking God's word out aloud? Won't people think I'm mad? Well, a lot of people are mad. Let me tell you this, who don't speak God's word out aloud. All you have to do is just sit, stand on the main road. You'll see people talking to themselves and walking, men. They're so preoccupied that they're talking to themselves and walking, women, sometimes children. They're not fanciful. They are not fanciful. They're so preoccupied. You just stand on the pavement. For half an hour, you will see not less than three people pass you talking to themselves. They're not talking to anybody else. Now, what we are expected to do is to mutter God's word aloud. Why? Because we are reminding ourselves of a God who fulfills his word to us. That's why we are empowered for good success. The other day, I was reading something about the prince of preachers, Spurgeon. This was written about the man. Every time he would be tempted to think otherwise, he would say out aloud, I believe, I believe, I believe God in his word. I believe. He would say it as many times as possible till he came to a place where he would start believing what earlier he was tempted to doubt. God's word says he's good, tempted to doubt it because of some circumstance of life. He would say, I believe God is good. I believe. I believe. And he would express his belief in something so solid from God's word. That in time he would start believing what he said he was believing. When you start muttering God's word out, it is not fixed to one time period. It is by day and night. Sometimes you can actually hear your spirit sing while you're sleeping. Sometimes you can hear your spirit man praying while you're sleeping. And you know you're sleeping. You will get up with a song in your heart. Words of the song so clear. Actually, if you tell yourself to sing it out, if you are careful to listen, you can sing it just like that. But once you start thinking and singing, you'll mess up with words. You won't be able to get the words right. It may be a song you just heard once. Your spirit man heard it clearly. It blessed him. It edified him. He latched onto it because it's from the word. So it doesn't mean you have to sit up all night long and all day long and all night long. No. God knows exactly what we require. Remember, he was the one who told Elijah, eat and sleep. Arise. Eat. After that he ate, he slept. Again, arise, eat. Because the journey ahead is very far. You need a lot of strength. So God knows exactly what we require. Now come with me to verse 3, please. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither. Whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Now prosperity is linked to verse 2. Prosperity is not apart from verse 2. Some people think, well, if I just give, it's enough. No. No. Giving is just a part of the blessing. But delighting in the word of God is the complete blessing. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. That means steadily, perennially, this person is planted where running waters flow. Not stagnant waters. Rivers of water, fresh water is his portion. He doesn't just get so much that he starts to rot. He's getting sufficient that is required for his living. Planted. Then he bringeth his fruit in his season. That means every man is a fruit bearing tree. But some people miss their season of fruit bearing. Why do you miss your season of fruit bearing? Because you're not planted by the rivers of water. When are you not planted by the rivers of water? When meditation of God's word is no more your delight. You've thrown it aside. You don't want anything to do with meditation. Muttering out God's word aloud is no more a delight to you. So then your season of fruit bearing is broken. His leaf shall not wither. Everything you require to have a healthy tree, they say, is manufactured in the leaf. That's the place where the entire manufacturing unit runs, each leaf. Life flows from the leaf. And it's amazing because it causes the leaf not to wither. This is an amazing phenomenon. In fact, the first thing that you will find when the roots of a tree begin to die, it affects everything including the leaf. The leaf also begins to wither away. So there's such a connection between planted, the roots going into where the rivers of water flow, and then the leaf not withering. Whatever he doeth shall prosper. The whatsoever is such a powerful word. He will plant a tree, the tree will bring forth. He will put an investment, the investment will begin to reap benefits. He will start a project, he will finish the project. He will lay hands on the sick will recover. When he is on the team will see prosperity. Unbelievers won't know what to call the person. But they know if the person is with them, blessing is on. Prosperity. Whatever he doeth shall prosper. Whatever. Because the foundation is right, whatever he does will never be wrong. Now look at verse 4. The man who doesn't have God on his sights, and the word of God means nothing to such an individual. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Nothing solid to keep the husk in place. It joins the rest to the dust. When the wind blows, the chaff is driven away. That is how ungodly people are. They have no anchor in their life. When the storms of life blow, they are blown away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. Now, if you don't stand in the way of sinners, nor walk in the counsel of the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment. That means they can't judge you. They can't sit to pass judgment on what you're doing. Sinners cannot come into the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. God knows their way. But the way of the ungodly shall perish. Now when you stay long enough in the Cether to meditate on God's word by day and by night, you know that your way is known of God. You don't have to prove anything to anybody. That's why you hear people like Joyce Meyer say, you don't have to live your life out in such a way that you have to please everybody. You can't please everybody. Because the ungodly will never be pleased with your ways. They'll try to find fault. They'll try to somehow find something to disrupt what you're doing. Look at Daniel. Daniel didn't do anything wrong. He was a eunuch in the king's palace. All that he did was lift up his voice and pray so many times in the day. The ungodly didn't like it. So the ungodly plotted and planned systematically. They got the king to say something, and knowing the law of the land, that whatever he said was irrevocable, they got him to sign. What did Daniel do? Daniel did what he always did. He didn't close the window. He kept it open and prayed. To Daniel, closing the window was not the Cether. To Daniel, prayer was the Cether. I want you to write it down, please. Some people close the window and go to sleep. It's awfully quiet this morning. Some people close the window and go to sleep. Daniel chapter 6. Now, when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open in his chamber towards Jerusalem, towards the city of peace, Shalom, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day. And prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime. What a powerful word from the scriptures about Daniel. He kept his window open, not in arrogance. He knew his Cether was to be with God. Three times a day, he would be seen praying and thanking his God. He didn't cut short his prayer time. He didn't say, okay, let's wind up. He knew the writing was signed. He had irrevocably committed himself to God's care and protection. Look at verse 11. Then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. Now the word assembled . That's what we were talking about regarding the three categories of people. The seat of the scornful. The way of sinners. Verse 12 says, and they came near and spake before the king and the king's, concerning the king's decree. And what did they say? In verse 13, then answered they and said before the king that Daniel, which is of the children of the captivity of praise of Judah, regardeth not thee, O king, nor the decree that thou hast signed, but maketh his petition three times a day. What is the accusation? Not that Daniel was sitting in the bar. Not that he was loafing. Not that he was walking around with a bottle in his hand. That's not the accusation. He's praying three times a day. They don't like it. Simple. They see you praying in tongues, they don't like it. Why do you find every single place you go and ask for a place for the church, the first thing they ask is, are you of the Hallelujah gang? That means something about Hallelujah is alien to the ears of the ones who have got out of their sight. Because the word Hallelujah is not praise Isaac. The word Hallelujah means praise Jehovah. Do I have an amen, please? It's praise be to God. And they say, are you of the Hallelujah crowd? Hallelujah crowd, no, we are not giving you the house. Hallelujah crowd, no, we are not giving you the place. Why? Hallelujah is not a bad word. But somehow, the people who don't know what it is to praise God don't like the word. Or they're upset about praying loudly or something, singing loudly or clapping their hands. So that's one way to scorn what God is doing. Now follow, please. Then the king, when he had heard these words, was so displeased with himself and set his heart on Daniel to deliver him. And he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. Then these men assembled unto the king and said unto the king, know, O king, that the law of the Medes and the Persians is this. Now I want you to highlight this, please. The law. Of the Medes and the Persians contradicted the law of God that Daniel was meditating on day and night. That no decree nor statute which the king establisheth may be changed. Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. The king spake and said unto Daniel, listen to what this man said. Thy God whom thou servest continually. Daniel was not some priest in the temple. He was an important official in the king's palace. And yet everybody knew he served not the king. He was not a man pleaser. He was a God pleaser. Do they know you as a God pleaser in your work spot? Or do they recognize you as a man pleaser? When the boss is around, he will work. The boss is not around, no work. Daniel was a God pleaser. He was not a man pleaser. And the king was acknowledging it because he was the boss of the kingdom. He said, your God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver you because I am unable to deliver you. Can you understand the futility of putting your trust in man? The Bible says, cursed is the man who puts his trust in flesh. But blessed is the man who puts his trust in the Lord. Why? Because he will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. So who's the man who's the planting of the Lord? The man who meditates on the word day and night. You meditate on the word day and night. You're not an ordinary individual. The God whom you serve continually will deliver you. And a stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den. And the king sealed it with his own signet. And with the signet of his lords. Two seals were put. That the purpose might not be changed concerning Daniel. Then the king went to his palace and passed the night fasting. Neither were instruments of music brought before him. And his sleep went from him. Now the question is, was the king's fast what delivered Daniel? No. I'll show you why. Then the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste unto the den of lions. And when he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice. He wouldn't have been lamenting if he knew he was alive. And the king spake and said, Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God. Now this is an alien king acknowledging that this man was a servant of the living God. Whom thou servest continually. I want you to see the word continually. Continually. It's being emphasized by the main man of the kingdom. But there was no other accusation. Work not finished. Work not completed. Nothing. That was not the accusation. Is thy God whom thou servest continually able to deliver thee from the lions? Then said Daniel unto the king, O king, live forever. My God had sent his angel. Can I have an amen from this church? And had shut the lions' mouths. So it's a couple of lions in the den, not one. That they have not hurt me. Lions don't just necessarily have to bite you to hurt you. They can swipe you. So we are talking about a man who was utterly protected. Can I have an amen? One of the ways in which lions kill their prey is by biting the neck and breaking the neck. But to bring the prey down, lions swipe. And they say their swipe is so strong, it's like 450 pounds. Just coming and whacking a man. From whatever distance the lion chooses to swipe. There was no swipe. There was no bite. Why? Not because these were toothless lions. Not because they were clawless lions. Not because they were lions so weak that they couldn't stand. No. Please listen. My God had sent his angel and had shut the lions' mouths that they have not hurt me. For as much as before him innocency was found in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt. Nothing to cause the lion's mouth to be open. Innocency. Staying in the Cether of God. The presence of God. Then was the king exceedingly glad for him and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. In all probability he was dropped into a pit. He had to be pulled up. So Daniel was taken up out of the den and no manner of hurt was found upon him because he believed in his God. Make a note of that phrase. Because. He believed in his God. Right from the time he was taken and thrown in, he never once doubted God would deliver him. Because he was always in prayer before God. And the king commanded and they brought those men which had accused Daniel. And they cast them into the den of lions. These were the men who had judged Daniel earlier. They had said guilty. God said innocent. Do you hear an amen? They said guilty. God said innocent. Now what happened? And they cast them into the den of lions. They must have looked at these men and told them, after all, you're righteous men. If an unrighteous man like Daniel can come through the lion's den experience, how much more you? Go visit the lions. They said, no, we're not going. The king said, no, you better go. Because an unrighteous man is delivered. Now you got to prove your righteousness. You got to prove that you're not guilty. You're also innocent. Them and their children. That's why I told you, even children must learn to fear God. Do I have an amen? Don't sit and ignore a child and say, no, the child is exempted from worshipping God. He's after all a child. No, if you're having family prayers, the child is sleeping, wake up the child. Insist that the child comes and stays with you in prayer. The child can put on a long face. You must know how to let that long face leave. Don't let the child sleep. Get the child to come and sit and pray with you. Let the child hear you sing and worship the Lord. Why? Because when the curse comes, children are not exempted. Children are not exempted. And this is not just one portion of scripture. Even in the book of Psalms, you read about how children were taken and dashed by the enemy. Their heads were beaten into a mass of unrecognized flesh and bone. Their heads were dashed into pieces. So we're talking about the curse getting not just adults. The curse can get anybody. Look, please. The men were caught. Their children were caught. And their better halves were left free to live. Nobody is exempted. So male or female, just like the blessing can come to you, the curse can get you as well. And the lions had the mastery of them and break all their bones in pieces wherever they came at the bottom of the den. While they were midair, bones were being broken. You can imagine these lions not even allowing them to hit the floor. Lest one of them cried and said, my bone broke because I fell. No one's bone broke because they were dropped from the top inside. Every one of their bones were broken in midair. And that's a curse. We read about the curse getting Absalom. Where did Absalom hang? He hanged by his hair. Midair. His legs didn't touch the ground. He was helpless. Because in the place where he prided himself, he fell. That's the place of these men's fall as well. They had prided themselves in the law of the Medes and the Persians. They thought the law of the Medes and the Persians was so irrevocable. Nobody can set us up. We'll set Daniel up, we'll kill him. They didn't know the law of God was different. The law of God said, the man who meditates on the law of God will not die because the lions get the mastery of them. The Bible says the man who meditates on the law of God will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. He will bring forth fruit in his season. And this is what we see these men miscalculating. And the lion said the mastery of them and break all their bones in pieces wherever they came at the bottom of the den. Now, I wanted to show you Bible prosperity. Bible prosperity is there in that verse. We'll just read from verse 25 to 28 and then we'll pray and close. Then King Darius wrote unto all the people, nations and languages that dwell in all the earth, peace be multiplied unto you. I make a decree, look in your Bibles please, that in every dominion of my kingdom, men tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. He didn't say, you'll get your promotion if you follow my God. He said, you better fear and tremble before the God of this man. That's promotion. That's what Psalm 75 tells us. Promotion doesn't come from the east or from the west or from the south. Comes from where God is, from the north. Puts up one person, he pulls down another. For he is the living God and steadfast forever. He never changes whether you're outside the den or inside the den. He's deliverer. He's prayer answering God. He's the same yesterday, today and forever. A heathen king has seen the stability of the God of Daniel. He's saying he's utterly stable. He's steadfast in his love. So whether the storms of life are blowing and all hell has broken loose, or whether you are walking and everything is going good, God never changes in the way he deals with you. And that's why you can declare all the time, God is good. You don't declare God is good because a famous singer sang it. God is good. No, 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 no. You declare God is good because God is good. And that singer has seen and perceived from the word of God that is the message that every man must hear, because that is the first message that God wanted man to hear anyhow. Because you read about it in Genesis chapter 1. God saw what he had created was good. And when he created man, very good. Very good. He delivereth. Let's read it. He is steadfast forever, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be even unto the end. He said, I will come and go. This God will remain forever. The God of Daniel. And how true this man was. He delivereth and rescueth, and he worketh signs and wonders in heaven and in earth. He is Elyon, possessor of the heaven and the earth. Joseph's blessing was from heaven above and from the deep beneath the earth. Who had delivered Daniel from the power of the lions? You sang, we got the power. We got the power to deliver us from the power of the lions. We've got the power. So this Daniel prospered in the reign of Darius and in the reign of Cyrus the Persian. He prospered. Because God said, a man who meditates on my word day and night will prosper. That's what prosperity is, the Bible way. If you thought you could get prosperity just by giving, wrong. That's a lopsided way of understanding prosperity. Prosperity is linked irrevocably and heavily on meditating on God's word by day and by night. You shouldn't be offended that in a conversation, God begins to take center place. His word shouldn't be offensive to you when you hear his name being mentioned. Some people believe it's an interesting thing to talk about every other topic in the world. The most exciting thing is to have God in your conversation. And you relate everything to what you're talking to, what the scripture says. That's the most exciting thing. You're making God's word your delight, even in personal conversation. Then in times of need, you will see deliverance come the Bible way. The way of the living God. Just bow our heads in prayer, please. Tomorrow we are having 3 worship services, God willing. Every one of them must be anointed by God. Every one of them must be sustained by God. Most importantly, people like you, ordinary people with everyday needs, will be coming in. They may dress good, they may look good, but that's just the outside. On the inside, there's the hunger in their heart. Sometimes there is something that they need for God to do in their life. Ordinary people with everyday needs will be coming.